Carlo Acutis is proclaimed a blessed. Travel with us to the Italian city of Assisi to witness the beatification of this 15-year-old computer whiz who died in 2006. Pope Francis releases his new encyclical letter entitled Fratelli Tutti, that is, All of Us Brothers. Discover with us what it's about. And visit the newly restored Roman Church of Santa Maria in Aventino, the spiritual heart of the Order of Malta. For this and more, Vaticano starts now. Carlo Acutis is a blessed. From this point forward, the young Italian computer whiz can be officially venerated worldwide, and people can seek his intercession. A flow of young pilgrims flooded the streets and piazzas of Assisi for his beatification on October the 10th. These young students from the Emmanuel Mission in Rome are dedicating a year to missionary activity, taking to the streets to spread the love of Christ. And Carlo is their example.
Carlo Acutis is for me an example of a man of our age who gave his whole life to the Lord Jesus and at the same time was very joyful and had a lot of enthusiasm. He liked to travel, he had lots of friends, and this shows that we are too called to live holiness at this very moment of our lives. In such an ordinary everyday life, there are three things we need: the unity with the Lord Jesus through the Eucharist, and confession.
Because he lived in the same world as we do, he is very close to us and the way we live, and I think it is very moving to have such an example of an exemplary life which we can very easily relate to.
He gives me hope for our time because we live in a time where it's always going on about the catastrophes and how our generation's sort of ruining everything, and he gives me this hope of our time is just as good as any other to be holy.
He's inspiring me because he's an ordinary young man, and he just give all itself with Jesus to others.
The Beatification Mass took place on October the 10th in Assisi, Italy, the city of St. Francis. Though separated by 800 years of history, St. Francis and Carlo Acutis shared a similar love for Christ and apostolic zeal. St. Francis changed the perception of sanctity, showing the real treasure of the faith is not in earthly riches, but in love for God, for our brothers and sisters, and for creation. Blessed Carlo, a child of the new millennium, succeeded in traveling the path to holiness in this age of information technology and social media. Tapping into the eternal tools of salvation, the sacraments and the Eucharist, he brought them to the new reality, to the digital world. Born in London, raised in Milan, Carlo is now entombed in Assisi's Old Town Church of St. Mary Major, in Sanctuary of the Spoliazione, Italian for divesting, in reference to St. Francis' renunciation of riches. Here in this square, young Francis started his journey to holiness, divesting in front of his father and a crowd of people, putting away his past life and beginning a new one. Carlo instead finished his earthly journey and found his final destination here. A naked Francis was covered with his bishop's mantle and never after dressed in fine clothes. Carlo is still dressed in a hoodie, jeans, and sneakers, the first blessed of the millennial generation. Carlo's example inspires young people from all over the world to follow Christ in the Eucharist. An Italian YouTube star, Father Alberto Ravagnani, has found inspiration from Carlo's online evangelization.
Finally, maybe even the internet has its patron saint. He was like many computer enthusiastic kids. He tried to use the web to bring the gospel message and inspire many people, and he did it well beyond his real responsibilities. Carlo is a young saint for young people. He is the one who has shown us that it is possible to be a saint today, in this century, while you're passionate about computers, while you're watching TV series, while you're living the life that the world is telling you to live. To be saints is possible today. For me, this is the greatest and most beautiful message that Carlo gives us.
Interest in Carlo's story and example has already gone well beyond the borders of Italy. Father Piotr Wisniewski, head of EWTN Poland, tells us about a recent Eucharistic youth event in the city of Kowobrzeg, which this year was dedicated to Carlo Acutis.
On this poster, next to this joyful young boy, was the inscription, "The Eucharist is a highway to heaven." I think that this is a very strong call for contemporary youth. That is why the young people who came to this event at the Skratsutsu Shrine, but also all of us young people in Poland, young people here in Rome, and young people all over the world, so that if they really look at the Eucharistic Christ, they realize that by holding on to it, they can reach heaven very quickly. And they can already touch heaven during their temporal life. And when they receive the Lord Jesus in Holy Communion. And I think that the young people I had the opportunity to see here at this meeting understood it perfectly. They were very cheerful young people, praying, even though they had their faces covered with a mask, for known reasons. But their eyes were happy. The eyes were saying that the Eucharist really matters to them.
Yesterday, in Assisi, Carlo Acutis, a 15-year-old youth enamored of the Eucharist, was beatified. His witness indicates to today's young people that true happiness is found by putting God in first place and serving Him in our brothers and sisters, especially the least. A round of applause for the new young blessed.
Al nuovo giovane beato millennials.
The beatification of Carlo Acutis took place in the Basilica of St. Francis, where a week prior, the Holy Father signed his third encyclical letter, Fratelli Tutti. After a quick break, we'll tell you about the key takeaways from this new papal document. Carlo's example is inspiring young people from all over the world to follow Christ in the Eucharist. In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano. With Gregorian chant, Franciscan friars welcomed the Holy Father, Pope Francis, to Assisi's Basilica of St. Francis on October the 3rd.
La pace sia con voi.
The Pope came for a day's pilgrimage to sign his third encyclical letter, Fratelli Tutti. In English, all of us brothers. In it, the Holy Father explores the questions for which society is currently seeking answers. The 8 chapters of the social encyclical, as the Pope himself calls it, are dedicated to addressing themes such as human rights, globalization, pandemics, and migrations, where the Holy Father offers his perspective through the charism of St. Francis.
Putting in order, putting together.
We turn to the executive director of EWTN's Aussie group for the key takeaways from the wide-ranging 200-page document.
I would say that you find the takeaways basically in the chapter that the Holy Father dedicates to the parable of the Good Samaritan. It's basically one full chapter in which he applies the concept of the Good Samaritan to everything that requires help and assistance to change evil things into good things in the world. And I think the list of things that he mentions, and lack of fraternity, lack of solidarity, poverty, virus, you mentioned it. He said, I do not pretend to make a complete list of these things, but I do try to encourage Catholics to give the witness of this example of the parable of the Good Samaritan as a key interpretation to act upon the world, not only among individuals, but among communities and among countries and within the international community. That's his dream.
And if you look at the full pontificate of Pope Francis, how do you situate this document into all of his magisterium?
Well, he said it at the beginning. You know, there are some monsignors here joking with the name Recyclical, in the sense that he has recycled a lot of his text, and he's very open about it. You know, from the very beginning, he says, "I am kind of putting in order, putting together many of the things I have been preaching at different levels of magisterium." It could be, you know, during an interview at a papal trip, or it could be in a discourse or a homily or in some of the audiences. But his concept of the dramatic situation of lack of fraternity in the world, in one hand, and the other hand, his almost a mantra about the need of a culture of encounter, he has basically decided to bring all those concepts together in some sort of an order and turn it into encyclical, therefore giving it a wider magisterial importance.
To present it, among others, the Holy Father invited the Vatican's Secretary of State, Cardinal Pietro Parolin, the President of the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue, Cardinal Miguel Ángel Ayuso Guichot, and British Professor of Catholic Social Thought, Anna Rowlands. Cardinal Ayuso Guichot calls the encyclical a breath of fresh air for his work and outreach to other religions. He says it's highly significant that the Holy Father chose to sign it in the city of Assisi.
The fact that Pope Francis went to the place where there was, you know, the very place of Assisi, where Saint Francis of Assisi lived and is present today, is a sign of solidarity that shows that the contents of what is the encyclical is much in line with the spirit of St. Francis of Assisi.
To be truly human is to be willing to look at the world.
Anna Rowlands, professor of Catholic social thought and practice at the University of Durham in England, says the encyclical addresses important contemporary issues.
I think Pope Francis fears that we're falling into a culture of polarization. And what's really interesting about this document is he picks out social media as but one example of a culture of social aggression. So I think people expected this to be a document that would be about maybe war and peace and non-violence, and it is, but not in traditional terms. So it takes this much wider lens really on our wider culture and asks us to look at the ways in which there are small violences, small forms of domination and polarization in our everyday lives. And he picks up particularly the culture of likes and dislikes, of echo chambers that he feels prevents us from having a genuine cultural dialogue where we allow ourselves to be disturbed by the presence of those who think differently or maybe have a different context or a different set of origins. And I think he thinks it's partly because we've come to fear what that will demand of us.
Cardinal Michael Czerny, Undersecretary of the Migrants and Refugees Section of the Holy See's Dicastery for Promoting Integral Human Development, sees the practical use of the encyclical in daily life.
Each one can say, I start with the title, Fratelli Tutti, and I ask myself, what is that question for me? What is there in my life, just one thing where I could ask myself about the difference between how I am and Fratelli Tutti? That would be a good point of departure.
During the Angelus address on the same day in St. Peter's Square, Pope Francis presented it to the greater public himself.
The signs of the times clearly show that human fraternity and care of creation form the sole way towards integral development and peace, already indicated by the popes St. John the 23rd, Paul the 6th, and John Paul II.
E Giovanni Paolo II.
After the praying of the Angelus, copies of the encyclical were distributed to pilgrims present in the square. From the moment he chose the name Francis in the Sistine Chapel at his election, the Holy Father has made it a point to follow the charism of the saint, emphasizing his approach to the issues of safeguarding creation, interreligious dialogue, and reflection upon social issues. We'll be back after a short break with more on Vaticano. Though it's just the size of a coin, the keyhole of the Knights of Malta is one of the main tourist attractions in Rome. The perfectly framed view of St. Peter's Basilica allows the visitor to look at the Vatican City in a unique way. In one look, one observes three independent states. The gardens are the property of the Sovereign Order of Malta. The rooftops are Italy. And the Dome of St. Peter's is the Vatican City State. However, very few people venture beyond this door. These are the grounds of what the Order of Malta calls the Magistral Villa, the seat of government of the Sovereign Military Order of Malta. And this year, the Order is celebrating one of its great treasures, its spiritual heart, the Church of Santa Maria in Aventino. The occasion is the 300th anniversary of the birth of Giovanni Battista Piranesi, renowned Italian artist, engraver, and architect, who between 1764 and 1766 renovated his only architectural commission, the Church of Santa Maria in Aventino. Valerie Guyot is an art historian and is in charge of welcoming visitors. She explains why Gian Battista Piranesi was commissioned as an architect only once in his life.
In my opinion, it was neither a success nor a failure.
in the sense that for him, the church, this opportunity was to be able to project on a visual level, let's say, his thought on art in a somewhat critical time, where we were at the end of the Baroque. Neoclassicism began to be taken into consideration, and Piranesi was unique because he had a very different opinion to all his contemporaries, and he wanted to evoke, let's say, different arts, such as Egyptian, Etruscan, Roman, and Greek art, not only Greek art. So the church for me is not a failure, in the sense that simply this mental projection shows us what he thought of art in general.
Che dà a vedere quel che lui pensava dell'arte in generale. Entrando nella chiesa.
Entering the church, we can see the tomb of Piranesi, who is buried here in the midst of the tombs of others, grand priors and grand masters of the Order of Malta.
The high altar is also beautiful.
He made it completely in the Baroque style, with a theatrical play of light and with the apotheosis of Saint Basil. The church is very rich, both in ancient Roman symbolism, because Piranesi wanted to make it visible, and in all the past, ancient history of the Order of Malta, with a very particular symbolism, evoking both ancient Rome and the Order of Malta.
Evocando sia l'antica Roma e sia l'ordine di Malta. Questa chiesa è stata concepita come un.
This church was conceived as a mausoleum, we can say, for all the grand priors, but also the grand masters of the Order of Malta, both because we have tombs placed in the niches of the nave, and also because Piranesi used this color of the stucco white, which is very particular. There is no gilding, there are no excesses of color, simply to give the idea of an eternal rest, and this white is very striking indeed.
Questo colore bianco è molto suggestivo, effettivamente. La chiesa non è una chiesa parrocchiale, per cui non ci possono essere realizzati battesimi, matrimoni.
The church is not a parish church, so baptisms, weddings cannot be held here. It is a priory church for the exclusive use of the Order of Malta. And the most important ceremony takes place every June 24th for the feast of the patron saint of the order, which is Saint John the Baptist, where the Grand Master of the order receives the whole diplomatic corps and then has a reception in the gardens, and at the same time the church is also used, both by the Grand Priory and by pilgrims of the Order of Malta, who during a pilgrimage to Rome ask to be able to enjoy for a moment of prayer a mass in the church, which is generally accepted by the Grand Master, and so we bring to life this place of worship.
È accettato dal Gran Maestro e così facciamo vivere questo luogo di culto.
If you are not a member of the order, you can enter the church, but during a guided tour, not for Mass. For this, the church is open to the public by appointment, every Friday morning and twice a month on Saturday morning, for those who cannot come during the week.
Chi non può venire durante la settimana.
The previous Grand Priories and also the recent Grand Masters are buried in the church, and among them is the recent Grand Master Fra Giacomo della Torre, who died last April 30th in Rome, in the crypt under the altar.
Nella cripta, sotto l'altare.